This is Coding Math, Episode 11, Gravity. And this is the fourth in our series on basic physics for programmers. We first took a look at gravity back in Episode 9, the first video on acceleration. There we defined gravity as a force that pulls something down, and we kind of arbitrarily assigned a value to determine how strong that force was. Today we get a little bit more technical. The view of gravity as a force pulling objects down is specific to our experience as inhabitants of the surface of this planet. We see ourselves living on a flat plane, which we can represent by the x-axis, and up and down we see as the y-axis. So no matter where you go, gravity appears to have the same direction and magnitude. But as you pull away, you realize that the Earth is actually a sphere, and that the concept of down loses its original meaning, and really means towards the center of the Earth. In reality, the gravity vector for any point on Earth has a different angle, and of course, in reality, these would be 3D vectors pointing in all directions in space, but we'll stick to 2D for this series. But it's not just direction. The magnitude can change as well. On the surface of the Earth, gravity exerts a certain force. But as you move away from the surface, that force decreases. It's actually inversely proportional to the square of the distance. In other words, if your distance from the center of the Earth doubled, the gravity you experienced would be reduced by 4. We live in a very narrow region, so from the top of Mount Everest to the deepest oceans, you wouldn't really experience any change in the force of gravity, though it is measurable. Now, it gets even more complex when you realize that Earth is not the only planet. Actually, any bodies with mass exert gravity on each other, and the force of that gravity is dependent on the mass. So a larger body, meaning one that has more mass, would exert a stronger gravitational pull than a smaller body. If you are on the moon, you would feel about 1/6 the pull of gravity that you would feel on Earth. In other words, if you weigh 180 pounds on Earth, you would have the experience of weighing about 30 pounds on the moon. However, if you are on Jupiter, you would experience about 2.5 times as much gravity, so you would experience weighing about 450 pounds. The formula for the acceleration that a body has on another body due to gravity is g times m divided by r squared. Here, g is something called the gravitational constant, which I'll explain in a second. M is the mass of the object doing the pulling, such as the Earth, and r is the distance between the centers of these objects. Now, this gravitational constant is technically 6.672 times 10 to the 8th centimeters cubed g to the minus 1 s to the minus 2. But unless you're launching a rocket to the moon or something similarly critical, you can safely just throw that whole thing away and say that gravity is mass divided by the square of distance. Again, we're talking about coding games, non-scientific simulations, UI elements, etc. Also, realize that I said that any two bodies with mass attract each other. So just as the Earth is exerting gravity on you, you are exerting gravity on the Earth, pulling it towards you. Now, because the Earth is massively more massive than you are, it's exerting much more gravity on you than you are on it. In most cases, this factor can be ignored. But if you're simulating two bodies of comparable mass, then you'd probably want to figure out the gravity that they are exerting on each other. Now, how do we convert all of this into code? Let's say that we have a solar system here, with a sun and a planet. We can use particles for these, and I'll use this as an opportunity to add a few more useful features to the particle object. Now, the sun has a mass, capital M, and the planet also has a mass, small m, and this tells us right away that the particle object probably needs a mass property, so we'll make a note of that. This planet also has a velocity. We'll say it's something like this. And we know that the sun is exerting gravity on the planet, pulling it towards itself. Now, of course, this planet is also exerting a small amount of pull on the sun as well, but we'll ignore that for now. This gravity is actually an acceleration vector, so it has an angle and a length. And we'll just need to add that vector to the planet's velocity on each frame. Now, we can figure out the angle from this planet to the sun. That might be another useful method, angle 2, which can get past another particle and return the angle between the two. We already know how to do that from episode 5 on arctangent, but having a method will make it easier. So the angle of this gravity vector is this angle. And what about length? What is the magnitude of this gravity vector? Well, we just defined gravity as the mass of the attracting object divided by the distance squared. We have the sun's mass. We'll need the distance between the sun and the planet. That'll be another useful method, distance to a second particle. So now we can say that the length of the gravity vector is m divided by the distance squared. Now that we have this gravity vector defined, we're good to go. We take this existing velocity of the planet, and we take this gravity vector, and we add them together. This gives us a new velocity vector, and tells us where the planet will go on this frame. On the next frame, we take the current velocity, and we have a new gravity vector because it has a new distance and a new angle. And we add those together, and we have the next velocity. The planet moves there. We do that again, and we get a new position for the next frame. And again for the next frame. And we keep doing this. And if we continue doing this, this gives us an orbit. Now this seems like a pretty useful thing to do, so we can probably consolidate this all into a gravitate to method. Okay, I think we have all the theory we need to start writing some code. We'll start with the usual simple animation template. Make sure that it includes the vector and particle libraries. And as always, you can download the code for this week's example at github.com/bit101/codingmath. Let's first jump over to the particle.js file and implement the enhancements we just listed out. First, the mass property, which will default to 1. This is a kind of arbitrary unit of mass, which can mean whatever you want it to mean. Next, we'll create the angleTo method. This takes another particle as a parameter. It uses math8tan2 to get the angle from this particle to that other particle. It does this by calculating the distance between the two on the x and y axes. Remember that math8tan2 takes the y parameter first, then x. Then the distanceTo method. This also takes a particle as a parameter. It also gets the distance between the two particles on the x and y axes. It then squares them, adds them, and takes the square root of the sum. And this is the Pythagorean theorem in action. I still haven't covered that on a video yet, but I'll get there. In the meantime, that's how you find distance. Finally, the gravitate to function. Again, this takes another particle that will attract this particle. First, it creates a new gravity vector, leaving it at 0, 0 to start. Then it gets the distance between these two particles. Then it sets the length of the gravity vector using the formula we just covered, the mass of the attracting body divided by the distance squared. Then it sets the angle by calling angleTo. And finally, it adds this gravity vector to the current velocity. And that does it for particle. Now we just need to create a couple of particles and have one gravitate towards the other. Back in the main JS file, we'll create the particles, calling them sun and planet. Sun will be located center screen and have no velocity. We won't be updating this one anyway. Planet will be located 200 pixels off to the right and have a velocity of 10 and an angle of minus math pi divided by 2, or straight up. Then we'll set the sun's mass to be quite large, 20,000. We don't need to worry about the planet's mass, as we won't be doing any calculations that need it. The numbers I'm using here were just attained through trial and error. I just tried different numbers, tweaking them until I got the effect I wanted. Now we just need to jump down to the update function and call planet gravitate to sun, then planet update. And all that's left is to render them. This is just the normal circle rendering for each particle, but we'll give each one its own color and a different radius. Finally, we can fire this up in the browser, and look at that, an orbiting planet. Try playing with some of the different parameters that go into this, such as the initial speed and direction of the velocity, and the initial distance of the planet from the sun, and of course the mass. For example, if I change the mass to 40,000 while keeping everything else the same, we get a much faster elliptical orbit. And if I bring it down to 10,000, the planet's velocity is affected, but not enough to pull it into an orbit. One instance that could require some explanation is if you create a so-called collision. We can do that by bumping the mass up to 100,000, which will pull the planet in really quickly. In reality, the planet would crash into the sun, and that would be that. But since we haven't programmed in anything for collisions, what happens is that the distance becomes very small, approaching zero. Remember that the length of the acceleration vector of gravity is calculated by the mass of the sun divided by the square of the distance. So when the distance is very close, the acceleration gets very large. As distance approaches zero, gravity approaches infinity. So the particle flies off in some seemingly random direction at high speed. Other than the lack of collision code, this is not really a bug. This exact phenomenon is used by NASA to send satellites into deep space. The satellite is programmed to come close to a large planet, and as it does so, the planet's gravity pulls the satellite, making it go faster and faster. If you aim it just right so that it gets very close without crashing, it will shoot off at a much higher speed. You can see here that Voyager 2 used this maneuver on four planets to help it build up enough speed to escape the sun's gravity. So that's about it for now for gravity. We'll be back next week to probably expand on this and look at some new concepts. See you then.